Sing, Lee.
Sooner, come on, I dare you to point at yourself and say, sooner,
sooner or later,
it's gonna take me forever,
my faith.
Pastor Carrie. And listen, I'm so thrilled that you are here. I am reminded as a little girl growing up on the west side of Las Vegas, I attended a small Baptist church. And every Sunday morning, a mother would get up and say, I don't know what you come to do, but I come to praise the Lord. Listen, I don't know what you are in need of today. I don't know what you have been praying for, what you have been asking God for, but I come into agreement with you that today's service is going to answer that need. Today's service is going to be the answer to the prayer that you have been asking God for. Listen, we are so thrilled to have you. On behalf of our pastor, Dr. Jamal H. Bryant, we are thrilled that you are here to join us for our New Birth virtual experience. Listen, hold on to your seats because I can guarantee you that this service is going to bless you in ways that you never imagined. Come with me as we go on into our service.
Deliver me, 'cause all I seem to do is hurt me. Just say that.
It won't work.
One more time, say it.
It won't work.
Hey.
It won't work.
Say it again.
It won't work.
No, it won't.
It won't work.
Matter what's going on.
It won't work.
Matter what's going on.
It won't work.
Don't be discouraged.
It won't work.
Don't throw in the towel, y'all.
It won't work.
Just keep on moving.
It won't work.
I said keep on moving.
It won't work.
You gotta keep on pressing.
It won't work.
You gotta keep on pressing.
It won't work.
You gotta keep on moving.
It won't work.
You gotta keep on moving.
It won't work.
You gotta keep on moving. Somebody needs to hear that today.
It won't work.
I know we're in the midst of a pandemic, but
It won't work.
COVID-19 is still not going to work.
It won't work.
It won't work. Injustice in this world. Forsake you.
God is with me.
That's the word of the Lord today.
God is with me.
Lord, I'll be with you always.
God is with me.
Even until the end of time.
God is with me.
Even until the end of time.
God is with me.
I'll never leave you.
God is with me.
I'll never forsake you.
God is with me.
Mother and father forsake me.
God is with me.
I've got a promise.
God is with me.
But just say this.
Because you're with me.
You ought to worship and say it.
Because you're with me.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you're with me.
This is our testimony.
I will not
thank you.
Oh, magnify the Lord with us. We don't want you to just watch us. We want you to worship with us. We have not come to entertain. We've come to lift up the name of our conquering King. We're grateful for the gift of the precious Holy Spirit that has met us on this day. We're grateful that our sister Leandra has helped usher us into the Holy of Holies. I hope that you've invited somebody. I hope you've tagged somebody. I hope you told somebody that worship is taking place right now with New Birth. What a monumental and historic week that for the very first time in history, there's an African-American woman on a national ticket. What an amazing season for all of us to make sure that we are registered to vote and mobilize to do so. For the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about making it to the top 10. And I'm believing for your life that whatever your field, whatever your area, whatever your specialty, God is going to elevate you to be in the top 10 of that. For students, you're going to be in the top 10 of your class. On September 13th, all of us are going to be in the top 10, sharing with God tenth, a tithe of what it is that God has given over to us. I want to draw you now to the Word of God. I hope you'll meet me in Genesis chapter 27. Genesis 27. And I want to highlight and illuminate verses 21 through 23. Genesis 27. Would you secure your Bibles? Go to verses 21 through 23. Then Isaac said to Jacob, "Come close so I can touch you, to know whether you are really my son Esau or not." Jacob went close to his father Isaac, who touched him and said, "The voice is the voice of Jacob, but the hands are the hands of Esau." But he blessed him anyway. I want to preach for a little while today using as a subject, something don't feel right about this. Something doesn't feel right about this. Last year at the World Economic Forum, Dr. Adam Grant from Wharton Business School went to glean how the most influential leaders handle power. His findings are quite chilling, as analyzed in his recently published book entitled Power Moves. He argues, hear this, that givers are better leaders than takers because takers are overconfident and are found guilty of taking unnecessary risk only when it's self-serving. Takers devalue other people's ideas and take delight at their downfalls, assuming it opens a door for their come up. They have a rough time keeping talent when it is that they come into power because they end up exploiting other people's gifts. Givers are great leaders because they lift others and they create opportunities in spaces where they don't exist. The problem, and I want you to be knowledgeable of this, the problem is that givers often don't get promoted. And they don't get promoted because they don't participate in shameless self-promotion. The question today is, are you a giver or are you a taker? And I want to say to you what you probably have never heard in church. Sometimes givers come in last because you end up giving away your opportunity, giving away your door, and giving away your chance. Dr. Grant says that those in the most senior positions of authority, hear this, do the worst job of picking out good character. The irony is that they actually think that they do well. The more powerful you get, the harder it becomes for you to choose good character out of people, because when you are powerful, people are bent on trying to impress you. All the takers are drawn to you because they know to get close to you means they'll get ahead. The more powerful you are, the more you have to rely on the people around you to give judgment about the people you are bringing close. If you really want to judge somebody, see how they treat the people who are lateral. See how they handle the people who are below. How do they treat you when they know they can't get anything from you? Now, if this premise is true in business, how much more so when you are anointed? You probably in all your days have never heard this, but I've got to give you the late breaking news that anointed people have a rough time picking good people, because you don't know who's in it for you, who's in it for your anointing, and who's in it for what they can get. So anointed people a lot of times are left vulnerable because they have been taken advantage of from people who you actually thought were interested in you, and they didn't know they actually were drawn to your anointing. The truth is, not everybody is competent at judging character in others. The ability to read requires a willful, active discernment. Sometimes we refuse to see what is evident, even when it is obvious to other people. Conversely, there are those that actually think that they are good at it when they are really clueless. But what happens? Hear this. When you know it, when you see it, but you still don't act on it. The question that I've got to ask you this Sunday morning is, how in the world did you allow yourself to get hurt by who you know you should have never been with? How in the world did you get injured when God gave you every indication? Today, I want to take issue with a common interpretation of Genesis 27. By the time we get to this chapter, Isaac, who we were introduced to as a lad because he got saved by a ram in the bush, is now an old man. He's going blind in his eyes and he's decaying in his body. As is the custom, he calls for his oldest son, whose name is Esau. And he tells him to go hunt for something for him to eat before he bestows a blessing on him. I got to park here parenthetically because I think I drove past too quickly. Did you hear what I just said? The father is getting ready to bless him, but says, I need you to go hunt first before I give you the blessing. In other words, the father was saying, I'm going to make you work for it, but I'm only going to make you do a job that matches your talent, that matches your assignment, that matches your call, matches your gifting. And hear this, he says, I need you to do it before I give you something. I'm going to make you fight for something. Many of you are getting ready to receive the greatest blessing of your life. And the indicator is not a rainbow outside, not a dove on your doorstep, not dew in the grass. The evidence that God is getting ready to bless you with something big is he's making you work harder now than you've ever worked in your life. And it's taking so much out of you that you can't even figure out, where is the relief from me having to work so doggedly hard? God says, I wanted to see whether you work, because God is not in the business of blessing lazy people. He needs to see what are you going to put into it. And while it is that Esau is on the hunt, exercising his talent, his mother doesn't have favor with him, but is more partial to his twin brother, Jacob. And she conspires to fool the father and give the blessing to the other son. Because Esau is hairy, she put an application on the arms of Jacob. Hear this, so he would feel like his brother. And then she does something that's blown me away, that I've never seen in commentaries, that I've never read in any exposition of the text, is she then pulls out, hear this, what Esau is hunting for. Wait a minute, Pastor, what are you saying to me? I'm telling you, what he is hunting for is already in the house. So you mean to tell me you already had it, you just didn't want me to have it? A whole lot of family members who have what you need. A whole lot of friends who have what you need. A whole lot of associates who have what you need, but they take hellish delight in watching you on the hunt. They'd rather see you struggle than give you the appropriate aid. God is getting ready to bless you, so that your season of having to put your life on the limb just to take care of your family is getting ready to shift. It's getting ready to dilapidate. I want you, if you would, to come with me now inside the tent. I want you to come in the tent with me and see what happens next. Jacob goes in. He goes in with fake hair on his arms, carrying meal prep. And the father says, how did you find it so quickly? And he lied to his father and said, the Lord gave me success. I want to say to you that your testimony will not be a lie. When people ask you, how did you pay that bill off so fast? God gave me success. How did you recover from that heartbreak so quickly? God gave me success. How did you find a job when you just got fired? God gave me success. How in the world did you get back on your feet when you were knocked clean on your back? God gave me success. Verse 21 is where we come to the rising climax of the text, where it is that the father says to Jacob, come here. Says, come here. I want to touch you. I want to touch you to see if it's really you. Because I'm in conflict. The voice is Jacob, but the hands are Esau. Maybe you forgot what happened in Genesis 27, verse number 1, is that the father is now going blind. He's going blind, hear this, but he is not losing his sense of touch. He's going blind, but he is not losing his capacity to hear. The father said, come in close. I want to feel you, because the voice doesn't match. And then the text says something in verse 22 that completely blows me away, is that he blessed him anyway. His sight is off, but his hearing isn't, and his touch isn't. And all this time, while it is that we have been vilifying Jacob, we have never taken issue with the father Isaac. My argument, my axe to grind, my angst today is against Isaac. And I need you to hear this, because I believe with everything in me that Isaac knew it wasn't Esau, but gave it to him anyway. He second-guessed himself and decided to bless him anyway. And before we march Isaac to the guillotine, before I strap Isaac to the electric chair, Before I condemn him to a life sentence on Rikers Island, I got to ask you a question. How many times did we know better about somebody but still gave them our body? How many times did we know better and we still loaned them money? How many times did we know better and still wasted our time? Even when it didn't feel right, we overrode our gift of discernment. And in other words, we told the Holy Ghost, shut up. I know what you're saying, but I know what I want to do. And so many of us are not poor judges of character. We should just be disqualified from the jury. Because God has shown you who ain't for you, what you shouldn't be in, what you need to walk away from, who you need to cut off. And here it is, it ain't just in the voice, they don't feel right. And they keep trying to come close and God keeps trying to push them away and it don't feel right. They try to pretend like they care, but you know it ain't authentic. They have the gift of lying with a straight face. They know how to pretend compassion. But you know what real love is supposed to feel like. Something is off about this. And yet over and over and over again, if you're watching me and you're over 30, off the top of your head, you can think of two people where the alarm went off. The sirens were blaring. The lights were flashing. The pickup truck was pulling up. But in spite of it, you still did what you wanted to do when it didn't feel right. I know I've come across the field and I know this is the long way home, but I got to ask you this, because you think you are a good judge of character. You think you can tell when people are trying to play you, use you, take advantage of you. I got to ask you this question. What is it that doesn't make you feel right about giving God your money? You mean to tell me you believe that he raised Jesus from the dead, but you don't believe he'll return your tithe? You mean to tell me you believe that a 16-year-old got pregnant with no contact and delivered the Savior of the world, but you don't think you're going to get a return of 40, 60, 80, 100-fold? You believe that he's coming back again, but you don't believe that your seed is going to return after not too many days? I'm trying to figure out, what is it about God that don't make you feel right? What is it about God that has made you lose trust? And I figured it out on my way to worship this morning, that the reason why it is that you don't feel right about God is you are more like Isaac than you'll confess. You're more like Isaac because it's clear to me now, you done lost your eyesight. You done lost your vision. Look at what God has shown you, that I've never seen the righteous forsaken or a seed begging for bread. I need you to see in the middle of COVID how it is that you watching me in your bed, but there's no ventilator connected. I need you to see how it is that your child was labeled to never be able to excel. And so God got him private education on a public school budget that they're able to do it at home on a computer you didn't pay for. I'm trying to figure out, what is it that you don't see about God that over 200,000 people have died, yet you walking around Target with no mask, you in the restaurant without washing your hands, you're hugging people and you don't know where they came from, and you believe that his grace and his mercy doesn't endure even until this hour? Maybe you're more like Isaac then you're willing to admit. Your eyesight is gone. But not only is your eyesight gone, God is saying, like he said to Jacob, come here so I can feel you. Yeah. You don't feel like a worshiper. You don't feel like a praiser. You don't feel like somebody who's filled with thanksgiving, because all this morning we've been lifting up God and you've been sitting there like you watching Netflix, but with my hands lifted up, with my heart filled with praise, I will bless thee, O Lord. Jeremiah said, I'll never speak your name again, but it feels like fire. And it's shut up in my bones. I want to tell you from a backwards perspective, I thank God that sometimes the Heavenly Father is just like Isaac. Pastor, what do you mean? I want to say it again. Sometimes the Heavenly Father is just like Isaac. Jamal, you got to help me with that. He's like Isaac because I know I'm not the one he should have blessed. But he keeps on making a way out of no way. There are people who are more focused, who are more disciplined, who are more spiritual, but he keeps looking beyond all of my faults and he meets me at my needs. I get joy when I think about what he's done for me. Can I tell you, I feel all right. I feel like lifting him up. I feel like giving him glory. And if anybody asks you, what's the matter with me? Tell them I'm saved, I'm sanctified, and I'm running for my life. I got to ask you, can you feel it? I feel like God is getting ready to do something for people who should have been disqualified. Can you feel it? The last are about to be first. Can you feel it? He's saving the best for last. Something don't feel right for me to be around people who claim to be believers but are not tithers. I don't feel right about that. I'm trying to figure out how you claim that you love him but you won't serve him. I'm trying to figure out how it is that you trust him with everything else but your stewardship. I'm trying to figure out how it is that you won't bless him when he's giving you stuff, here's your shout, you didn't have to hunt for. You didn't even have to work for. He said, I'm going to give you a harvest that you didn't plant. I'm going to put you in houses that you did not build. I don't feel right about it. I'm telling you, he's been too good to me. You can't make me doubt him. I know too much about him. I want to let it go, but I'm not finished. I got to tell somebody, God's been so good to me that I've got to give him glory. I got to give him praise, and I've got to give him my sacrifice. The critical question that theologians have not been able to answer is, why is it that once the father figured out he was duped, that he couldn't undo the blessing? Because when God gives the blessing, he never pulls it back. He gives his gifts with no repentance. I'm so thankful. There's some areas of me you just found out about, but God already knew about. He blessed me when he was intimate with my brokenness, my frailty, and my issues. That's why you don't need other people's opinion in order for you to receive the favor. God knew you while you were still in your mother's womb. And because of that, you ought to be giving him glory. I'm going to challenge you. I want to ask you a question. What's wrong with you that you won't give God your best when he's always found giving you his best? I need you to grab your phone, wherever it is. I need you to grab your phone. Get your device. I want all of us to partner together. That God, you have shown me so much. Even though I wear contact lenses, even though I wear glasses, even though I'm nearsighted, I'm farsighted, you have shown me so much. It wouldn't feel right for me not to give you my best. There's some people who I was raised with, who I used to hang with, who I used to run with, who are not alive today, but he has sustained me. There are five of y'all who should just be throwing your laptop across the living room. You ought to thank God he delivered you from who you knew you should have never been with. who you chose even when God shut the door, you unlocked it and let them back in. I want you as a gesture of thanksgiving and repentance. I want all of us collectively, corporately, I want us to give God our gift, our tithe. I want you to do it without any pause, without any shadow of turning, without any hesitation. I want all of us, we ought to be giving, knowing that God saw me even in my worst season, in my worst time. All of us ought to be giving God our best expression. What is that best expression? Is our tithe. 10% of our income, whatever it is that is coming this week. I don't care whether it's through Zelle, whether it's come through your Cash App. Whatever you got this week, you ought to be giving 10% of it back over to God. An amazing testimony is in this house. Amazing testimony is in your house about how God has been so faithful. All the more, I want you to not just give your offering, not just give your fiscal expression. I want you today to give your life over to God. Give your soul over to the Master. My team just shared with me this week that since COVID, over 1,000 people have joined this church. Since COVID, over 1,000 people have committed their lives over to Christ. I'm telling you that God is doing a new thing. And you may not be here, but the Spirit of God is there. I want you to join this church. Don't fight it. Don't hesitate. Don't deliberate. Everything in you has, in fact, given you the confirmation. You are a good judge of character. And God has shown you New Birth is the kind of church you can trust, where you can be rooted, where you can be planted. On yesterday, over 8,000 people received groceries. On yesterday, almost 2,000 people got free COVID-19 tests. And today, even while you're watching, thousands upon thousands of people are worshiping with us corporately. Come on in the room. Be a part of this amazing move of God and see what God does. Because the blessing He's about to put on your life will not be reversed.
Good morning, New Birth. My name is Donna Harris. I'm a single mom and a longtime member of New Birth. I just want to tell you a little bit about my tithing journey. In 2019, I was laid off. Most of the year, was unemployed, yet I still tithe. Found another job in the beginning of this year, and in March of 2020, the pandemic hit and my job shut down. Again, unemployed. But what I do know is I could not stop tithing. I tithe whatever I had received, I made sure I tithe. And God has kept us, he kept me, my son. There's nothing that we don't need. I paid off a car during the pandemic. And what Pastor has always preached, what he preached was, we're gonna prosper during this pandemic. And what I need you to know, that God is true to his word. And all you have to do is tithe and prove him. And he shall come through for you.
I'm outside of the emergency room of Atlanta's most formidable hospital, and there are no beds left. As a matter of fact, not just at this hospital, no areas in the county have any room. My dear friends, COVID-19 is wreaking havoc, and I don't want a member of our church or community in line to get one of these beds. And so we've got to operate with wisdom. And with that knowledge, we are shutting down all in-person worship indefinitely. But we are not going to stop giving God glory through streaming. And so on New Year's Eve, you have two opportunities to worship with us online at 12 noon and 10:30. Nothing will be missing. Mary, Mary, you're still coming. The gospel is still going up and people will still get saved. We are a part of a community that doesn't just commiserate over what is the problem without offering a solution. And so beginning on Monday, January 3rd, and every day for the next 2 weeks, we're opening our doors for free rapid COVID testing. Our responsibility at New Birth is to spread Christ and not to spread COVID. I'm praying for you. I'm celebrating with you. And I can't wait to see you when the old Negro spiritual comes to pass, that the storm has passed over. Happy New Year, and I'll see you online.
Time, everybody.
just say it.
I know who saved me. I know who raised me. His name is Jesus. And he's mine. He's mine.
Just one more time, you ought to say it. Now take 30 seconds and put on the screen. He's a mighty God. He's a mighty God. Come on, let's worship. He's a mighty God. And we lift him today. He's a mighty God.
I'm outside of the emergency room of Atlanta's most formidable hospital, and there are no beds left. As a matter of fact, not just at this hospital, no areas in the county have any room. My dear friends, COVID-19 is wreaking havoc, and I don't want a member of our church or community in line to get one of these beds. And so we've got to operate with wisdom. And with that knowledge, we are shutting down all in-person worship indefinitely. But we are not going to stop giving God glory through streaming. And so on New Year's Eve, you have two opportunities to worship with us online at 12 noon and 10:30. Nothing will be missing. Mary, Mary, you're still coming. The gospel is still going up and people will still get saved. We are a part of a community that doesn't just commiserate over what is the problem without offering a solution. And so beginning on Monday, January 3rd, and every day for the next 2 weeks, we're opening our doors for free rapid COVID testing. Our responsibility at New Birth is to spread Christ and not to spread COVID. I'm praying for you, I'm celebrating with you, and I can't wait to see you when the old Negro spiritual comes to pass, that the storm has passed over. Happy New Year, and I'll see you online.